Have you ever encountered a situation where a fact that you were convinced was true is proved false? Suddenly you see that your assumptions were wrong, and the world is no longer the same. One place where this happens often is at university. Here, students are encouraged to look closely at the world, from the perspective of science. What they discover sometimes topples firmly held beliefs. The experience can change both the way you look at an issue and your worldview. You suddenly realize how much you don't know. As Socrates said, "To know is to know that you know nothing." That is the meaning of true knowledge. As uncomfortable as this is, it's a normal part of learning. An honest awareness and appreciation of the limits of our knowledge fuels curiosity and scientific discovery. By thinking critically, we can avoid misconceptions and stop falling into old traps. But what is a misconception? Misconceptions are incorrect beliefs. They're an important issue in science education because they're very common and because they have a negative impact on learning. This makes complete sense when you think about how knowledge is constructed. Imagine that you're building a wooden Jenga tower. Something goes wrong. The logs on the bottom are supposed to be solid, but somehow the tower starts shaking as you build higher and higher. The weight of the upper logs is not supported by the logs below, and over time, the whole thing falls apart.
Good game.
The same thing happens with knowledge. Our conceptions need to be solid if we are to build on them. Otherwise, the entire cognitive structure may collapse. Let's look at a misconception using a small thought experiment. Imagine a tree. A huge tree, like the giant sequoia or California redwood, which can grow to a height of more than 100 meters and have a circumference of 10 meters. Where does all that wood come from? The wood in a tree comes from A. the soil. B. the air. C. mostly the soil, a little bit from the air. D. mostly the air, a little bit from the soil. If you're not a biologist, you may have thought what many people think, that wood comes from soil. In fact, only a tiny fraction of it does. Most wood is formed by photosynthesis, whereby carbon dioxide gas in the air turns into solid material. Your students are not blank sheets when they arrive in class. In their heads are both correct concepts and misconceptions. These can peacefully coexist. The flood of information, emotions, distractions, messages, and values that bombards us every day easily lets us compartmentalize. Correct ideas go in one box and contradictory ideas in another. When people think about how a tree grows, many don't consider chemical reactions but assume that solid material arises from something else solid, like soil. The assumption is based on what they've seen in other contexts in their lives. Such misconceptions can be deep-seated and very hard to correct, so they need to be confronted. Confronting misconceptions isn't just about asking students what they already know. If you ask them, "Have you heard of this concept?" they may say yes, but you have no idea whether what they know is correct. Instead, get them to explain the concept. Don't just ask whether they know what photosynthesis is. Design and initiate a confrontation.
It's very well known that in physics and in many other science areas, students have some ideas of concepts, but these concepts very often do not fit the scientific concepts. Students should understand from the very beginning the discrepancy between their own knowledge and the scientific explanation. This can be done by asking them questions where they for sure don't have the right answer, or by giving them showing them an experiment with an unexpected outcome. This makes learners aware of the discrepancy between their own knowledge and the scientific explanations.
We know that students learn most effectively if they connect new knowledge with prior knowledge. And you, as a teacher, are responsible for bringing that about. To access prior knowledge, which may be hibernating somewhere in a compartment in a student's brain, it has to be activated. How do we do that? Explicitly link new material to knowledge from previous courses. Begin a lesson by asking students what they already know about the topic. Brainstorm about it. Create a concept map, or reuse old slides, and so on. Use analogies or metaphors to describe and compare content. Bring hands-on examples that connect the topic to everyday knowledge. Create analogies based on everyday life which form robust knowledge representations in the mind. For example, when considering the ingredients in wood, ask about fire. What happens during combustion? Most students will know that during combustion, wood turns into energy and carbon dioxide, a gas. Where did that energy originally come from? Sunlight. Can the process be reversed? By now, you've probably tapped deeply into their prior knowledge.
The most important thing for improving learning is to consider students' prior knowledge. At the university, we have very often lectures with 400 students, and the question is, of course, how to deal with diversity in this complicated context. But the good thing is that if you have 400 students, you don't have 400 misconceptions. You probably have 3 or 4 misconceptions. And if you address these misconceptions, you serve almost every student.
The idea of fire turning a solid into gas certainly existed in one compartment of students' minds. In another, solid comes from solid, and soil is solid, so wood comes from soil, might still be found. Somewhere else, there was probably knowledge of photosynthesis, but in the context of green leaves, not wood. Now that you have unearthed this mixture, as a teacher, it's now your job to confront students with it and help them to resolve the misconceptions and integrate correct concepts into their body of prior knowledge. You can expose the wobbly Jenga logs by asking a logical sequence of Socratic questions, as in a tutorial. Or you can design an experiment which you know will have a surprising outcome. Before the experiment, get the students to predict the outcome, which, based on their misconceptions, may be wrong. After they see what actually happens, you can examine their misconceptions together. Your students may not like this approach, and that is understandable. It's disconcerting and possibly discouraging to confront one's misconceptions. The students might come away feeling that they're always wrong. They might say, "Stop telling me I'm wrong. Just tell me what's right." If you do that, though, they may never dislodge their little compartments of misconception. You will have to push them. But be gentle and never, ever be smug about it. The rewards are great. The students may now construct huge, stable Jenga towers of knowledge. For example, combining the understanding that the wood and plant matter, which feeds many animals, arises from carbon dioxide, with the knowledge that fossil fuels come from decaying plants and animals, reveals the whole cycle of sustainable and unsustainable energy production, and the processes of climate change. In summary, because learners construct their learning actively, log by log, it's crucial to consider the foundation which underpins it. So, make your students address what they think they know. Using questions or experiments, initiate confrontations. Get them to discover conflicts and contradictions. And then, very importantly, get them to explain and resolve the conflicting pieces of prior knowledge. If you do this, you will be helping your students to build solid foundations which will support the weight of the new knowledge they add during their studies.
Yes! Yes! Very sloppy in the case, yeah.